Cheney survived the vote. Kevin McCarthy's talking now. Let's listen.
She and I were both down in the skiff, and we heard what the FBI report was. No way would I ever leave him on intel nor Homeland. I'd question whether he should still be a member of Congress. And then you're going to look at Maxine Waters as a chair of what she incited? There are so many. I wonder if they put that same standard as someone else. Because never in the history of Congress has people been deciding where other parties are putting people on committees.
Senator McConnell said her views amount to a cancer for the Republican Party.
Well, I denounce all those comments that were brought up. Everybody, and she came to the floor, she came inside our conference and denounced them as well. She said she was wrong. She has reached out in other ways and forms, and nothing that she said has been based upon since she's been a member of Congress.
But she has
and the voters, the voters, no, the voters decided she could come and serve. When she sent and denounced all those, well, in the inside our chambers,
and apologize for her past comments.
That's exactly what she did.
Publicly,
that's what she did inside our conference.
Do Democrats deserve to hear that same apology that she delivered?
Well, I think everybody should hear that. And she has expressed that she has put it out from news agencies and others. I think it would be helpful if you could hear exactly what she told all of us, denouncing QAnon. I don't know if I say it right. I don't even know what it is. Any from the shootings, she said she knew nothing about lasers or all the different things that have been brought up about her. And so from that perspective, she's now a member. If we are now going to start judging what other members have said before they're even members of Congress, I think it's going to be a hard time for the Democrats to place anybody on committee.
Now that she is a congresswoman, if she says something like this again, should she be on committee?
I think people, now that you're a member of Congress, now it's a responsibility of our conference to hold people accountable. And you know the unique thing is? We have a long history of doing that, just as we were going to change something here. It's on the Democratic side that it's very difficult that they don't ever do that. When Omar made her comments, Wooden kept her on foreign affairs. We removed Steve King when he made comments as a member of Congress. What's unfortunate is that Democrats don't keep that same standard.
Mr. McCarthy, she has a long history.
Any other questions? He asked a lot of stuff. Let's do this. Let me let the whip talk, and let me let Liz Cheney, our conference chair, who just got a resounding shot in the arm, that we got a team. And remember what this team is. This is the exact same team that didn't lose one seat in the last election. When I saw a lot of you write stories about whether this team would survive after we'd lose 15 or 20 seats. No, we didn't lose one member, we gained. And a little later this week, we'll gain another seat as well. We'll be at 213. It'll be the slimmest majority in the history of modern history for Congress. And you know what that's going to mean? 2 years from now, we're going to win the majority. That's because this conference is more united. We've got the right leadership team behind it. And I look forward to watching to make sure we've got the right focus for this country on putting it back on track.
What was the vote count?
All right. Thanks, Kevin. Liz, tonight our conference rounded a really important corner. We spent hours where members on every side of this issue looked each other in the eye, aired their grievances, and we're very candid and honest with each other, but address this as a family and address this as a team, and ultimately finally worked to have a vote where we kept the entire team together. And we came out much stronger because now, while we've aired those grievances, everybody tonight was united in knowing that what is happening right now on the House floor, spending today over $2 trillion on a shell budget, with no real accountability for what they're going to do with the money when there's over $1 trillion still available to help people get their businesses open. President Biden alone in 2 weeks has signed executive orders to destroy millions of American jobs and ship those overseas, in many cases where they're going to emit more carbon making the same things we used to make right here in America. And his climate czar has acknowledged that he flies around on his own private plane emitting 40 times more carbon than if he would have flown on a commercial liner. So the hypocrisy is very clear. The damage that they're doing to our economy is very clear. And our resolve to unite, to fight for the hardworking families of this country, to round the corner on COVID, to get our economy back on track, to safely reopen schools, that resolve has never been stronger after looking each other in the eye, talking through the differences that we had, and finally coming back together as a stronger, united Republican conference. And with that, our conference chair, Liz Cheney.
Thank you very much, Whip, and thanks, Leader. We really did have a terrific vote tonight, a terrific time this evening. laying out what we're going to do going forward, as well as making clear that we're not going to be divided and that we're not going to be in a situation where people can pick off any member of leadership. It was a very resounding acknowledgement that we need to go forward together and that we need to go forward in a way that helps us beat back the really dangerous and negative Democrat policies.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Look, it's just an example. This Republican Party is a very big tent. Everyone's invited in. And you look at the last election, we continue to grow, and in 2 years, we'll be the majority. Thank you all very much.
Speaker Kevin McCarthy, there, the headline, obviously, that Liz Cheney has survived the vote that was taken on her leadership position. She's the third highest-ranked Republican in the House. Let's go to Ryan Nobles on Capitol Hill. Ryan, what else are you hearing about what happened?
Well, Anderson, I think we should point out what the vote total was. 145 supporting Cheney, 60 voting against her, and one voting present. That really isn't close. She truly had the support of the House Republican Conference here tonight. And I also think we need to point out how important it was that this was a secret ballot. This really allowed Republican members to vote their conscience and not have to worry about the blowback of casting a ballot in support of Liz Cheney and that somehow being interpreted as a vote against President Trump. So even though Cheney did receive strong support here tonight, we cannot ignore the fact that President Trump and his presence, the former president, I should say, still looms very large over this conference. And it will be interesting to see the juxtaposition of the vote total for Liz Cheney here tonight and how many Republicans vote to remove Marjorie Taylor Greene from those committee positions on the House floor tomorrow. Remember, that will be a public vote. We know who will vote for or against that. So those Republicans will have to be accountable for that. So it's quite likely here tonight that we're going to see Republicans that voted to keep Liz Cheney in her position, but will also vote to keep Marjorie Taylor Greene on those committees tomorrow, even though there will be more Democratic votes and she will likely be pulled off of those committees.
And let's just be clear, there's not going to be the Republicans chose not to hold a Republican vote on Marjorie Taylor Greene. They could have done that. They could have had a secret vote and chosen to remove her or not from those committees. Now they're just going to let the Democrats do it and then attack the Democrats for doing it.
Yeah, that's 100% right, Anderson. Republicans could have taken this action on their own. Kevin McCarthy could have taken this action on his own. He chose not to do that for whatever reason. He talked there in the press conference that we just had before you came to me about how he wanted to remove her from committees. He was looking for some sort of a compromise and that he, blamed the Democrats for being belligerent on that point. But the fact remains that he had the option to take some sort of action. He chose not to take that action. And now Democrats are going to do it for him, but there is still going to be an opportunity for Republicans to have a voice in this process. Just because they chose not to do it in this forum, they are going to have to vote on this tomorrow, and they will be held accountable for that vote, either for or against it. And I have to imagine there are a lot of these members of Congress that represent districts that President Trump won by solid margins that are going to be very reluctant to cast a vote in opposition of Marjorie Taylor Greene because of her close connection to the former president.
And Ryan, for McCarthy to say that they are more united, I'm trying to get the exact words, but united bigger than I've ever seen here in the past, that seems hard to believe.
I don't think you're the only one that is having a hard time believing the House Minority Leader's rhetoric as he comes out of that meeting. To his credit, it's not uncommon for Republicans to have these closed-door meetings where they really hash it out and yell at each other about their differences. But there is still a pretty big divide in this party. There are significant Republican House members that are very angry that Marjorie Taylor Greene is part of their party and is going to, still represent constituents under the Republican banner for some time to come. And let's not forget, Anderson, we're only talking about the House tonight, but there's a whole flock of Senate Republicans that are, have come out and very strongly denounced her role in this process, have said that she should be removed from committees, and have even gone so far as to say that she should not be a part of the Republican Party. So this is a divide that maybe for tonight they're showing somewhat of a unified force, but this is a lingering problem that's going to continue continue to exist as Republicans try and forge their way through this process. And a lot of it comes down to winning elections, right? You know, it tends to be that you can win an election as a primary candidate when you run close to President Donald Trump. But we are now starting to see a consistent pattern outside of those strong Republican House districts, you know, that are drawn in a way that have more Republican voters, that it's becoming more and more difficult to win with, as someone aligned with President Trump in a district or in a state that is even somewhat moderate. I mean, you don't have to look any further than the results in Georgia, which has, you know, been a Republican state for a very long time to see the outcome there. So this is the future of the Republican Party. There are still a lot of people who believe it should be close to President Trump, but there is still a portion of the party that believes it's time to move on.